So good morning all. So is it audible and visible? Is my screen visible to all and
yes, sir.
My voice is audible?
Yes sir, yes sir.
Okay, fine. Because I think one last class my voice was breaking. So okay, fine, no issues. So good morning all. Today we'll be discussing about advanced process. So what do you mean by advanced process? Why you call it as advanced processes? Any specific reason we have? Is there any specific reason for calling these as advanced processes? Okay, fine. So let me tell you the answer. So actually, if you see, means 8086 is a basic processor, and what are processes that we are going to discuss Kalyan hereafter?
Kumar? So we have Kalyan Kumar? What?
Yes, ma'am.
It is not in the full view presentation mode.
Okay, okay.
Okay. Or okay, okay.
Now it's fine, ma'am.
Yes, okay, fine. Okay, now.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, fine. So if you see, means these processors, whatever we are going to discuss hereafter, they'll have certain additional features. So when compared to what 8086, and we, since it is, has additional features, we call it as what advanced processors, advanced versions of your 8086, a basic processor. Okay. So we'll see or discuss what are the few advanced processes that we know actually. So we just have a look. Can you have a look at it? We have this basic process. We are going to discuss about these basic processes: 80186, 80286, 80386, and 486. And they are processes beyond this. Actually, after 486, we'll be discussing about Pentium processor also. Okay, your Pentium family comes into existence, and you can just have an overview of this. We'll see one by one in detail. So 80186 and 286 both has what 16-bit data bus, which means similar to your what 8086, whereas 80386 and 486 has 32-bit data bus. So you can imagine it works on what 32-bit with the help of 32-bit ALU. And moving on to address bus, 80186 is almost similar to what your 8086 having a 20-bit address bus, and 80286 has a 28-4-bit address bus, and similarly 80386 has 24 as well as what a 32-bit address bus. So that I will explain you in detail when we discuss in detail about 80386, and 80486 has a 32-bit address bus, and correspondingly the physical memory you can calculate by yourself. So 2 power 20 will get what 1 MB physical memory. So similarly you can calculate for the rest of the processors. And moving on to clock frequency. So as you know that what the frequency of your I think first one is a mistake. It is 5 to 10 megahertz, not 16. Oh sorry, 5 to 16 megahertz. 80186 is what 5 to 16 megahertz. Whereas what is the clock frequency of your 8086? It starts from 5 to 10 for different variants. So 5 to 10 megahertz, whereas 80186 starts from 5 to 6 megahertz. And you can see the frequency, clock frequency for the remaining advanced process, it keeps on increasing. So which means what? In terms of a performance or speed, these processes do much better than your 8086 basic version. Okay. And next is your pin count. And the last one is your year of development. So you can have a just overview. We'll see one by one in detail. So next is we'll move on to features of your 8086. So as I said, what 80186 it was developed by Intel. All the processors that we discussed are developed by Intel in the year 1982. So it is an actually improved version of your what 8086 with several common built-in functions like clock generator. So in case of 8086, we don't have an inbuilt clock generator, but in 80186 we have an inbuilt clock generator. We have system controller, inbuilt interrupt controller, DMA controller, so timers, all are inbuilt in this 80186. So it is an advanced version of your or improved version of your 8086. And moving on to instruction set, we have additional 8 new instructions in 80186. And you can just compare your clock frequency. Obviously, what your 80186 it gives faster than your what 8086. And similarly, like your 8086, your 80186 also has what 16-bit external data bus. It is also available. The 80186, no, it is also available with an 8-bit external data bus. So when that is the case, we do the type of processor we call name it as what 80188. So when 8086 is available with 8-bit internal data bus, we call it as what 80188 processor. And the clock frequency of this basic clock frequency of this one 80186 is based in 6 MHz, so which is quite high than your what 8086. The clock frequency of 8086 is 5 MHz, so this comes starting with what starts with 6 MHz, so which means what it works by exhibits faster, little bit faster than your 8086. And this is your architecture or block diagram of your 8086 architecture. Just you can have a overview. So okay, well, then we'll go in this, we'll discuss in detail about each function of each block. So just have a overview of the block. So what are the additional features, additional blocks that you have noticed in 80186? Can you name any one or two blocks that are added or additionally in 80196, or which is absent in 8086? You can just see the diagram and then block diagram and then compare yourself. 8086, do you remember we have only two independent units, execution unit and bus interface unit. Here if you can just notice we have additional units. Can you name them, those additional units? Here you can add what, the clock generator. So you can see the top rightmost, leftmost corner, top leftmost corner, we have clock generator, so inbuilt, so it is not there near 8086. And followed by what, program interrupt controller at the top row, third column, we have a program interrupt controller. We have programmable timer, and bottommost second column we have program DMA controller. All these are new in case of what 80186. Okay, fine. So they just have an overview, because with this block diagram we are going to proceed further. Okay. So here I have just listed out your what are the function blocks available in 80186. So what are the function blocks available? Just what are blocks that you saw, just those have been listed. I think we have 7 blocks. All the 7 blocks has been listed here. So starting from your clock generator, we have a bus interface unit, and then we have DMA controller or inbuilt. We have a programmable timer, 16-bit programmable timer. We have programmable interrupt controller, and then we have chip select unit also available. So, and then last one is the execution unit. So all these are available in your different blocks in your 80186. So we'll see one by one in detail. So first we'll start with register set. So it's the easiest one to start with. So we'll start with register sets. So actually, if you see, means 80186 has totally we have 14 16-bit registers. All the 16-bit registers they are grouped into what either one of these 5 categories. So it can be those five categories are segment registers, general registers, base and index registers, status flag, or otherwise called as what, flag register, and then control and status registers. So almost no, it will be similar to your 8086 only. 80186, no, it will be the architecture and addressing modes almost will be similar to your what? 8086. So if you are thorough, with 8086, you can able to easily understand the architecture of your 80186. Nothing much difference. So you can just have an look over the instruction sets available, registers available in register sets available in 80186. So we have special function registers. So 0 to 7 lower bit, and then higher followed by higher bit. These are general purpose registers. Segment registers we have, as well as what, control and status registers also we have. So almost similar, okay, similar to your what, 8086. So we'll see what is the function of each and every register set that we use. Okay, fine. So moving on to your first general registers. So as I said, 80186 process, it consists of what, 8 general purpose registers. So all these registers you can use to perform what, your arithmetic or logical operations. So out of these 8 general purpose registers, 4 of the registers, AX, BX, CX, DX, you can use these registers or as a 16 bit register, or you can split into pairs and use it as what, separate 8 bit registers also. Okay. So same, okay, same functioning as your what, 8086. So nothing much to say. And moving on to segment registers. So here also we have what, 4 16-bit special purpose registers. CS, SS, DS, and ES. So all these registers are used to select the segments of memory at any given time. So with the help of this, you can stack memory or data, so depending upon your purpose. Okay. And then moving on to your base and index registers. As I said, we have what, how many, so we'll be having 4 general purpose registers. Again, it's general purpose, okay. So BX, BP, and then SI, DI, index registers. So all these can be, normally we use these registers to determine the offset address of operands in memory. So I think, hope you would have gone to addressing modes. So in addressing modes, we have used these registers very often. So the main purpose of these registers is used to determine what offset address of operands in memory. And not only this, these registers may contain, sometimes it may contain say, base addresses or indexes to any particular location within the segments. For that purpose also, we go with what, these type of registers. Okay. And so the main purpose, what I want to say is, it is used in what, various addressing modes, okay, to determine your physical address of the memory for any operand. For that purpose only, we use these base and index registers. And then status and control registers. So here in 80186, we have 2 16-bit special function registers called as what, IP, instruction pointer, and status word. So what is the function of, I think, hope you know the function of IP. So instruction pointer register contains what, offset address of the next sequential instruction to which is to be executed. Okay. And then status word, as usual, okay, it is used to what, contains status and control flag bits. So for that purpose, we use what, status word. And one more thing that you have to remember is these registers, IP and status word, they are also used to what, record or sometimes even alter what, different aspects of your 80186 process state. For that purpose also, we use these registers. And moving your status word, so almost similar to your PSW of your 8086, nothing much different, almost similar. So it's a 16-bit register. So as I said, the status word, the word itself indicates, it is used to what, record results of any logical and arithmetic instructions. And sometimes there are certain bits which are used to what, control the operation of 80186. Okay, so within a specific operating mode. And as I said, it's a 16-bit register word. And here I have mentioned see, bits 0, 2, 4, 6, 7, and 11. They are used for what, arithmetic and logical operations. Whereas remaining 8, 9, and 10 are used to control the process operations. You can just make a note of it. See, if you see this diagram, it's almost similar to your flagged register diagram, PSW of your 8086. I think there is nothing much difference. Hope you know the function of all these registers, because these were asked in MCQ2 for a microprocessing, they were asked certain questions based on your auxiliary flag, overflow flag, and also. So anyway, just I'll have a quick summarize. I'll summarize quickly about the function of each and every status words. So carry flag. So when it will be set. So the carry flag usually will be set whenever there is a carry or a borrow is generated after any arithmetic operation like addition, subtraction is performed. So otherwise it will be cleared. Okay, this is the function of a carry flag. And moving on to parity flag. So I think this was also asked. So parity flag is will be set whenever the lower order. So whenever the lower order 8 bits of the final result of after performing any arithmetic or logical operation contains even number of ones. Okay, so whenever the lower order 8 bits contains even number of ones, parity flag will be set. If there is odd number of ones, obviously it will be what? Reset. And auxiliary carry, I think even this was asked. So when what do I think the question is like this. So when what happens when the auxiliary flag will be set? So this was a question asked in MCQ 2. So normally the auxiliary flag will set whenever there occurs a carry or a borrow at a lower order 4 bits of AL. So after performing any arithmetic or logical operation, okay. So whenever there is a carry or a borrow from the lower order at the lower order 4 bits of your AL, this auxiliary flag will set. Otherwise, it will be cleared. And moving on to zero flag, like I think it's very easy. If the result of any operation is zero, this flag will be set. Otherwise, it will be reset. And sign flag. The sign flag, which is almost what it will be set when it will be set. So the normally sign flag will be set if the result is negative, or you can say that if MSB bit higher order bit is one. Okay. So if the result again if this if there is it will be reset if the result is positive or MSB bit is set to zero. Okay. And then this see whatever so far I explained, all this comes under what the status flags. Okay. And then now we'll move on to what? And one more status flag is there, which is at the end, at the bit 11 position. So overflow flag, it is also a status flag, comes under a status flag. So whenever a signed result is too large and cannot be what expressed within the number of bits in the destination operand, obviously your overflow flag will be set. Otherwise, it will be cleared. So all this flags comes under a status flags. And remaining three, you know, it's a control comes under what control flags. So trap flag, interrupt flag, direction flag. So single trap flag, it's a single step. It is used in what single step mode. So whenever this flag is set, what happens? Single step interrupt occurs. So at what? So after each instruction, what executes? So trap flag, you can clear the trap flag with the help of what a single step interrupt, and IF. Interrupt flag. So when you set, when this flag is set, what will happen? So masterful interrupts will be enabled. Okay, so which will cause your CPU to transfer control to an interrupt vector specific locations. So for that purpose, we go for what IF. And last one is here, direction flag. So direction flag, hope you remember. So when direction flag is set, what happens? It is mainly used for string operations. So it causes the string instructions to auto decrement. Okay, well, the appropriate index registers which you use. Okay, so similarly, when you clear your direction flag or when direction flag is reset, it causes what auto increment. Okay. So in simply, if I want to remember, when DF is equal to 1, index register automatically decrement. If DX is equal to 0, index register will automatically increment. So this is the function of your what status flags. Okay, so it's easy. So far, whatever you have explained, almost the same as your what 8086. Okay, nothing much different. And whatever I'm going to discuss hereafter. So these are the additional features that has been there in 80186. Okay, fine. So from here, I may ask you some few questions. So 80186. So what about 8086? Whether it has inbuilt clock generator or it has a external clock generator in 8086. In 8086, we have external, very good. So we have external clock. But whereas in this case, 8086 has it has an on-chip clock generator. So this clock generator, you can use it for both external as well as what for internal clock generation. And the main features of this clock generator are it has a crystal oscillator, and then it has a divide by two counter. So divide by two counter, I think hope you studied in DPST counters. synchronous counters or simply counters mod 2 counter. Synchronous ready inputs, asynchronous ready inputs, and then what? Reset circuit. So all these are including your what? Or features of your clock generator. So what is the duty cycle of your 8086? Do you remember what is the duty cycle of 8086? Not sure whether they have asked in MCQ 1 or 2, but I think I have seen this question. Duty cycle of 8086. Even ma'am had mentioned it twice, I guess. I'll be teaching you. What is the duty cycle of 8086? You don't remember? Okay, fine. The clock frequency of duty cycle of 8086 is 33%. Okay, but if we compare here, the 8086 clock frequency provides what? Nearly 50% duty cycle across the clock for what here? So which means what? Actually, there is an option to divide the oscillator output by 2. So that's why we use what this divide by 2 counter. So forming what is symmetrical clock. Since we have divide by 2 counter, we can divide the oscillator output by 2. So it forms what is symmetrical clock. So whenever external oscillator is used, so what happens? For example, okay, let me tell like this. Suppose you are using external crystal, which has a frequency of either 12 or 16. So if that external crystal is connected to 80186 operating at 12 or 16 megahertz, then what will happen? It will generate what? 12 or 16, I said, no? So it will generate what? 6 or 8 megahertz internal clock. Okay. So you can divide by 2 and then you can split, you can use it internally or externally, depends. Okay. And then, so we're moving on to DMA controllers. I think, hope you know what is a DMA controller. What is the function of DMA controller? Or what is a DMA? Even this ma'am have discussed you in teaching your unit number 2. Direct memory access, very good. So for what purpose we go use DMA? Or is there any specific reason of using DMA? Specific reason for going with DMA? Direct memory access. From the name itself, you can able to what? Guess the answer. To access certain memory. Okay, fine. So to access certain memory when it is what? Without interrupting CPU, very good. See, at least you should be able to what? Remember these points, hint points, okay? Without using my CPU, it's one valid point to access memory. And the data transfer rates are very high. So like this, you can remember points. With that, you can able to what? Frame yourself. Okay, fine. So in 80186 also, DMA controllers, if you notice, means here we have what? 2 independent high-speed DMA channels. Okay. So actually, there is architecture diagram separately available for this DMA controller, which is there within the 80086. But no need to go much in detail about that architecture diagram. So just you can have an overview. So 80186 DMA controllers, it has what? 2 independent high-speed DMA channels. And so data transfers can take place between memory and I/O devices, or between memory to I/O, or I/O to memory, or even within the same space, like memory to memory or I/O to I/O, so whatever it may be. So all these are possible with the help of what these channels, okay? And as usual, data can be transferred either in 8 bits or bytes, or you can also transfer with the help of what, 16 bits or words, okay, from any even or odd address, okay? And then if you know, if you have noticed, means in case of 801 866, each DMA channel consists of what, 20 bit source and a destination pointer. So which means the content of the this index pointer can be either decremented or incremented depending upon your data transfer byte or word operations. Suppose when the data transfer is 1 byte, so obviously what, the pointer will be incremented by 1, and whenever the data transfer is 1 word, means the pointer will be incremented by 2. So okay, and so in general what I want to conclude is each data transfer will always take what, 2 cycles. So 2 bus cycles. The first bus cycle is used to what, fetch the data, and the other bus cycle is can be used to what, store data. Okay, so this is a simple overview of what DMA controller, which is available in 8086. So if you still want to go through this, you can just go through in details available. I can just share you the notes. You can just go through, but like actually not much required. Okay, fine. So next is next additional feature which is available in 80186 is a timer. Okay, so here also in 80186, no, this microprocessor has 3 internal 16-bit programmable timers. So out of these 3 timers, the two are highly flexible, which means like highly flexible in the sense means you can program to count either what external events, and they be, and they can be connected to what, external pins. So these 2-pin timers are external pins, and the third one, and for example, no, these with the help of these 2 timers, which I said which are highly flexible, they can be used to what, to count any external events or time external events, or even you can use to generate what, any non-repetitive waveforms. For that purpose also we can use what, these 2 timers. And the third timer, which I said, it is used to, it is not, normally it is not connected to any external pins. So the reason is this timer can be used as a used to interrupt the 8086 after a programmed interval of time period. For that purpose we use what, this is the third timer. Okay. And then what is additional feature that we noticed in 80186? So another additional block that is available in 80186 is your interrupt controller. So 80186 has what, interrupt controller. So which means it can receive interrupts from both internal sources as well as what, external sources. Okay. For example, the interrupt, the internal interrupt controller means we have option to merge all the interrupt requests on a priority basis. And it provides what, individual interrupt service by the CPU. So we have interrupt options. I think you know what is the interrupt priorities and all. So based on the interrupt priority basis, it will be allocated, and that will be given what, individual interrupt service by the CPU. And even timers, DMA channels, or they also comes under what, internal interrupt sources. And these sources you can be disabled with the help of what, with the help of that control registers. You can use, you can disable with the help of your control registers. Or there is another option, you can also disable by mask bits, okay, within the interrupt controller. So don't worry, we'll be studying in detail about these interrupt controllers in your unit number 3. So there we will explain what is your mask bits and all, okay. So because we have a separate unit and separate topic for interrupt controller, we will be studying in detail about all, okay. So and 80186 microcontroller, it also has control registers which can set the mode of operation for the control also. We have that additional features also. Okay, and then actually we have two different modes. Okay, so before going to next interrupt controller, I think the next slide will be 80286. Okay, so okay, before going this 286, we can just have a small what to say, comparison between 8086 and 80186. We'll see how much you have understood. So I just forgot about this slide. 80286. We'll just have a small comparison between 8086 and 80186. So what is the major difference that you have noticed in 8086 and 80186? H186 had timers, very good. Then See, if you compare and study, it will be easy for you to remember. That's the main point I want to mention. This way, clock generator, timers, interrupts, all these are additional features. Very good, Vignesh. And then anyone DMA, okay, fine. So you're able to just compare and see. Okay, fine. So normally you can say that what 80186 is, just I'll summarize quickly. So 80186 is improved version of 8086. So in the sense, improved version, the sense means it can execute a faster instruction. Okay, well, our execution time will be what, little faster when compared to 8086. Okay, and it also has what, a few more additional instructions compared to what, 8086. And here we have what, in 80, if in 8086 we have DMA channels, it is program interrupt controller, and the pro timers and chip selector, all these are not available. It has not been incorporated in 8086. Whereas here all these are been what, incorporated in 80186. High speed DMA channels, your program interrupt controller, program timers, programmable chip select logic, all these are been incorporated in 80186 processor. And the frequency, that is the main point you should remember, the clock frequency. So there it is what, 5 to 10 megahertz, but whereas here it's what, it starts from where, 8 to what, 10 megahertz. So see the difference, to 6 to 10 megahertz. And here we have, so actually you will not be able to, if you see instructions, no, as I said, we didn't discuss in detail about what instruction set, so you will not be able to know. Here I said we have what, additional instructions, but in 8086 we don't have those instructions. Okay, we cannot compare this. Okay, fine. And one thing which we have to remember is 8086, no, it has no high level instructions, whereas in 80186, no, we have three high level instructions like bound, leave, enter. So all these are something high level instructions. We'll see in detail where it will be used, this process. And the pin count, I think you can also mention the pin count. Hey, there your 8086 has 40 pin, and whereas it is what, 40 pin dual in package, whereas 80186 has 64 pin IC. You can remember that point. And power consumption in 8086 it is more, whereas in power consumption in 80186 is quite less in compared to what, 8086. So these points you can just remember whenever they ask you. So next we'll move on to what, 80286. So you can just have introduction alone. Okay, 80286. So you can just refer. So I think 80286 was introduced in year what, 1981, 80186. So next year, 80286 was introduced, also known as what, IAPX 286 version. And it has what, main point that you have to notice. So it's, it is the first Intel processor that could run on what, all software returns for what its predecessor. And it is a 80286 is the first processor that will, which has the capability to run on all softwares which return for its what, predecessor. Okay, and the clock frequency, just you can make a note of it. Actually, initially, if you see, means 80286 was released with 6 and 8 megahertz only, but later it was subsequently, it has been scaled up to what, 12.5 megahertz. So initially it was 6 and 8, and later they have been improved, okay, to 12.5 megahertz. And then obviously you can performance, what, whenever the clock frequency increases, you know what will be the performance also. So the 80286 performance will be more than twice your what, 8086, because the 8086 clock frequency is just 5 megahertz, and here it is 12.5, which means more than twice, okay, or 2.5 times, you can just roughly to say. So 2.5 times what, your 8086. And then 80286, it has what, 24-bit address bus, and which means what, 24-bit means how much amount of physical memory it will have. So 2 power 24, so it is roughly up to what, 16 MB of RAM, read write memory. Okay, so and one more important feature of 8086 is the 8286 CPU, you know, it is designed to run multitasking applications, also possible with the help of what, this processor. Okay, and here, no, 80286, it can make this 80286 to work in two different modes. One you call it as what, real mode, other one you call it as protected mode. Okay. This real mode is used for compatibility with existing 8086 software base mode, whereas the productive mode is used for enhanced system level. So we'll be having additional features like multitasking, protection, memory management unit. So all this will be included in case of your water productive mode. So this is first processor where we are having this option, productive mode option. Okay. Okay, fine. So these are the, I think these are the basic characteristics or features that you can remember with the help of 80286. Next, we'll move on to architecture of 80286. So just have an overview. See, no need to get tensed about the architectures. So everything looks same. The only thing is, if you're able to remember or remember the blocks present, you can. If you know the function of each and every block, you can able to explain it on your own. Okay, well, so almost it will be similar to 80286. Nothing much different. So each one will be having a certain added features. That's the only thing you have to remember. Just have an overview. So what are the different units we have in 80286? Just have this look at this block diagram, and then you can see what are the units available. Twice the speed. Okay, fine. What are the blocks available in 80286? I think the screen is audible. Address unit. Okay, Kaushika, then. So here we have what, four units. See, just have a look at this block diagram. If you are thorough with your block diagram, so you really can write everything on your own. Nothing to just go through also. If you know the function of each and every block, what does it do? So you can write on your own, okay? So here we have what, four units, individual units. So address unit, execution bus unit, instruction unit, and execution unit, okay? So all the blocks are there very clearly. So we'll see what is the function of each and every. I think, hope you know. You can guess what would be the function for what each and every modes. Okay. Okay. So first we'll see one by one. So what is the function we'll have? Just we'll just complete this alone. So four units, as I said. So first we start with address unit. So what is the function of address unit? Function of address unit. Fetch the address, very good. So, so fetch means, it means that what? He's mentioning that you have to compute the address, physical address. So the address unit is main purpose of this address unit is used to determine the physical address of the instructions. And the, not only on instructions, as well as the operands which are stored in memory. So that is the main function of your what, address unit. So it is used to compute your 20-bit physical address based on what, the contents of the segment register. And sometimes we'll be having a 16-bit offset similar to your 8086. Okay, so with the help of these contents of the segment register and 16-bit offset, you can able to calculate or compute your 20-bit physical address. Similar to 8086, nothing much different. And not only this, address lines can be used to address what different peripheral devices like memory, I/O devices, and all also you can use. And the physical address is computed by the address unit, which is, that calculated physical address will be sent to what? Bus unit of your CPU. So that is, these are the functions which your address unit will perform, okay? And then moving on to your second unit called bus unit. So what is the function of bus unit? So when I say bus unit, so the main function would be what? You have to interface the 80286 with the memory and I/O devices, okay? And here it has what, a 16-bit data bus and 24-bit address bus, and it also has what, a control bus. Okay, this 80286 has, I repeat, it has 16-bit data bus, 24-bit address bus, and along with a control bus. Okay, and the main purpose of this bus unit it is mainly responsible for performing all your external bus operations. Okay, and main components are this bus unit. The bus unit, no, it consists of what, latches and drivers which are required for address bus. I think, hope you know, we have seen about latches and drivers. When ma'am taught you the basic configurations of 8086, minimum mode, maximum mode, there would have noticed latches, okay, drivers, okay, same case here also. The address unit, the bus unit connects of latches as well as drivers, which help of what? We can transmit the address A0 to A19, and this in turn what it will use to for performing what read and write operations. And apart from this, the bus unit it also used to what fetch instructions from the memory. Okay, and here you can say just to make a you can see in bus unit you can think you have you noticed the block diagram? Just a minute, I'll just go back to the block diagram. Okay, see just have a look at this block diagram. Bus unit we have what a 6-byte. Prefetch queue, we have something. So what is the purpose of this unit? So it is one of the function of this bus unit is it is used to fetch instruction bytes from the memory. So generally the instructions they are which are fetched in advance, they'll be stored in this queue for what? Mainly for the faster operation execution of the instructions. And this concept only called as what? Instruction pipelining. Okay, well. So that's what I have mentioned here, instruction pipelining. So that's what I have mentioned here, instruction pipelining, okay? So so which means what? Suppose if you want to fetch instruction, the CPU here, it will not wait until the completion of execution of the previous instructions. So while one instruction is being executed, obviously the successive instruction will be prefetched, it will be decoded, and will be kept ready for execution. Okay, so the prefetcher model, which is available in this bus unit, it performs this prefetching task. And the bus unit, it has a bus control model, which controls this prefetcher model. Okay, so the prefetched instructions, as I said, will be arranged in what 6-byte prefetch queue. So in this way, what happens means your CPU will prefetch your instructions. So main this all this we are doing to increase your water speed of execution. So by doing this we can increase your speed. And next is your instruction unit. So it has a 6-byte prefetch queue. So whatever instructions it forwards those instructions to what? So successively to the instruction unit. Okay. Well, so from the 6-byte instruction queue, the instructions will be forwarded sequentially to where instruction unit. So the instruction unit it receives the instructions from the prefetch queue. And it decodes one by, them one by one. So the decode instructions, again, they are latched onto the decode instruction queue. We have a decode instruction queue. If you just look at the diagram, we have a decode instruction queue. So all the decode instructions, they will be latched onto this decode instruction queue. So the instruction, decodes maximum what? 3 prefetched instructions and loads them into what? This decode instruction queue for execution by the execution unit. And last comes here what execution unit. So if you see means so the output of the decode instruction queue is fed with what the control circuit of the execution unit. So the main purpose of this execution unit is responsible for what executing instructions which are received from this decode instruction queue. So as I said, the execution unit will consist of what register bank, so temporary registers usually called as arithmetic and logic unit ALU, and then control block. So register bank, so what is the purpose of register bank? So to store the data, okay, so for as a scratch pad, so temporary purpose. And it is also used as a special purpose registers for certain applications. ALU, it's a core of your execution unit. It is used to perform all your arithmetic and logical operations. And so the result of this ALU will be either sent, sent to the data bus back to the register bank sometimes. And control block. The main purpose of control block, it is used to control the overall operation of your execution unit. Okay, well, so okay, fine. So I think I can stop with this. Okay, I think I'll stop with this. It's tap to time. So we'll continue the next remaining topics in the next session, right? Tomorrow, next week. So if you have any doubts, you can just post your questions.